Hello there, I'm Joseph.
And I'm Mariana.
And today we are here in a beautiful village, just outside of a beautiful village called Sarcedas. And it is a beautiful Xisto stone village. Portugal has a few of these Xisto villages. They have the group or the organisation called Aldeias de Xisto. And you can check their website. I'll put that on the screen here. And it has all of their different villages listed on it. Xisto is the Portuguese word for slate, a type of stone. And in these villages, of course, where they have so much of this stone, they make all of their little houses, or they used to make all of their little houses out of it, and they look absolutely fantastic. They are really, really stunning buildings. Well, we are here today about 20 miles outside of Castelo Branco in Sarcedas, and we are looking to show you a fantastic Xisto building which is for sale. It's really, really gorgeous. It's 40,000 euros, and yeah, I think you're gonna like it. So yeah, let's take a little look around. As we walk down this private track here down the hill, it leads to the farm and only to the farm. It doesn't go anywhere else. And right down in this valley, which I'll show you in just a second, the farm butts up to a fantastic, lovely, large stream. And that stream is actually slightly uphill, upstream from the Praia Fluvial. A Praia Fluvial is a freshwater swimming beach. Lots of villages here in central Portugal have them. And yeah, we're going to go down there and show you the Praia Fluvial straight after we've viewed this fantastic property. And like I was saying about the Xisto stone, me and Mariana found this lovely bit of Xisto on the floor here, of which there is quite a lot. And you can see they really are lovely, lovely slate stones. So yeah, it's a gorgeous, gorgeous slate building, and the whole village is made out of slate. It's really, really lovely. But yeah, let's look around the farm.
Yes.
And now you can see at the bottom of the track this beautiful valley here. It really is lovely, and you can see all of the little schist walls and everything. You can drive right down to this point so you can get right to the house. And speaking of the house, if I turn the camera, here it is. It is a gorgeous, gorgeous little cottage in the valley here, in the mountain valley. I really like that. That is exactly the sort of property that I love. Really, really beautiful. And if I pop to the side a little bit, you can see, although you're quite isolated here on the mountain, you can't see. I think I need to come further over. If I come over here, you can see there is the village in the distance over there. So you're really not that far. You're only a few hundred meters from the village, but it feels like you're further because you're in the forest here, and it is absolutely stunning. It's just isolated enough where you're far away enough from people where they're not going to be shouting and you can hear cars and things, but also close enough where you can get everything you need. And there's quite a lot nearby to this property as well. Like I said, you've got the Praia Fluvial, so you can go down there and they open up for snacks and drinks and things. And yeah, you'll see that towards the middle of this video when we leave this property. And yeah, close by in the village of Sarcedas and everywhere, you've got mini markets, you've got health centres, you've got everything you should need, really. And then, of course, you've got Castelo Branco, which is only a stone's throw away, about 20 kilometres. And yeah, you've got everything there. That's the largest city in our region, only 20 kilometers from here. So you've got everything that you would need: shopping malls, I don't know, grocery stores, supermarkets, everything like that. So you really don't go without, obviously, hospitals and everything like that. They're not far away at 20 kilometers, which is lovely. So yeah, as we step onto the property here, it is 1.4 hectares. And we're just walking over this lovely little overflow ditch, and look at that. That is that is really, really pretty, really quaint, fairy tale-esque. And the farm here has a few little terraces by the house here, right by the house. So that'd be perfect for chicken shed and veg patch and everything, don't you think, Mariana?
Yeah.
I know she likes it. She likes all of these little quaint villages, don't you?
Yeah.
Beautiful, beautiful. So yeah, you've got enough room here, like Mariana said, to do your own little projects and things near the house, veg patches and all of that sort of business. And you've got a few fruit trees here as well. You've got a couple of grapevines, you've got a couple of peach trees. There's at least two I can see there. A pear tree, there's a persimmon tree, there's an apricot, and I think there might be a little apple tree there as well. I can't really see, but I think it's a little apple tree. But yeah, so you've got quite a few a few fruit trees. The property here has about 1 hectare of forestry as well, which is lovely. And yeah, then the property line goes down there. I'm going to pop on the screen here a drone image so you can see exactly where I'm talking about and exactly where we're standing. Rightio, Mariana. Should we go inside?
Yeah.
Let's take a look. Let's have a look in the downstairs first, I think. So of course this property is a ruin on the inside. It's got a nice new-ish roof. The tiles are all new. Needs new rafters and everything, of course. I'm gonna pop my torch on my phone here because I reckon it will be dark inside. Can you get in?
Yeah.
There we go. It's a rustic lock if ever I've seen one. And you can see the width of the walls here is got to be, my hand is 20 centimeters, so 1, 2, 3, a minimum of 60 centimeters, maybe about 70 centimeters. So yeah, of course, this property will require complete internal renovations. At the moment, as you can see, it has been used as what they call here an adega, which is a winery. So here, everything is wine-based inside the property here. So what would you have? You would have, first of all, your primary fermentation, which would be these stone boxes here. They would be where the grapes would be put into and crushed, and then the grapes would go into their secondary fermenter, which in the case of the olden times would be these beautiful oak barrels, and they would give the wine a fantastic oak flavor. So yeah, absolutely gorgeous. Nowadays they tend to do them in stainless steel kubush or secondary fermenters, but yeah, they used to be done in barrels, and I do like a nice bottle of wine that's been fermented in a barrel. It's got that lovely oak flavor. But yeah, so this is quite a small property. Of course, it's not that big, but that's because it's only ever been used for a small little family, and it wouldn't have been necessary to have a massive house in these stones that would have also been extremely expensive. So yeah, and look at all of those all of those beautiful bottles and everything there. This one's still got some liquid in it in there. Lovely. Aguardent, I think, as well. I'm sure the owner told me that this one here would have been used to make aguardent. That would have been where they put the alum beak or the still. That would have been where they had the still, heat it from the bottom, and then your aguardent would drip slowly out. Fantastic. Aguardent, for anyone who doesn't know, is like a Portuguese moonshine, and this one would have been for the wine. So yeah, fantastic. A few litres of wine to be had in there. There's also quite a lot of headroom in this property. Mariana, you're about what, 2 foot tall, aren't you, something like that? Mariana's about 5 foot, so that shows you the headroom there. I'm 6'2", so that shows you there's quite a lot of headroom. But of course, you would have to put in a new flooring and everything like that. I know fantastic builders, electricians, plumbers, everything, people that put septic tanks in, boreholes and whatnot, and all of that sort of business. So I could definitely put you in contact with all of those people, and they would give you some fantastic quotes and everything, and they would do a marvelous job. This house is north facing, and the slope, so north is that way, so the slope is coming down on a westerly angle there, so you get all of the sun coming from behind the house here. So you could put solar panels on the back side of the house, which in actual fact would be perfect, because you wouldn't want your solar panels right on the very front of your house, really, would you? You know, it would spoil from that shishto look. So yeah, you don't have to put solar panels here. Of course, you could put power lines in. You could call the electric company and get a quote for power lines. I do think it would probably be more expensive though, considering the distance to the village here. I'm assuming that's where the closest power lines are, because it's where the closest houses are. So yeah, I would definitely look into getting solar panels here. And yeah, because they would go on the back side of the house, I think that'd be fantastic. Rightio, should we take a little look upstairs?
Yes.
Yep, up we go. So this farm used to have a water mine. You can still see where the water mine sits on the land, but of course it's been decades since it's been used, as you can see from the inside of the house. So yeah, of course that would either need cleaning out again, or my personal opinion would be to install a borehole. That would definitely be the best bet. They cost around 40 euros per meter as you go down, and you don't need to go down that many meters when you're on the side of a mountain here. Mountains have lots and lots of water. But yeah, let's take a look at the upstairs. Rightio, in we come. Again, you've got those absolutely massive, thick stone walls here. And yeah, the floorboards are maybe not that trustworthy because they are quite old, so we won't be tap dancing in here anytime soon. You've got a lovely large window there. I'm not talking about the pane on the floor, I'm talking about that one there. And yeah, the rafters, although they are not that old, I probably would say get some new rafters in there, I would imagine. But the owner did tell me that he had the roof done not that many years ago. And as you come up here, you can see there's a big hole on the opposite side. If I walk over there, be a daredevil, you can see that hole there, that would be from where they would have a fire downstairs. And then you can see all of the black on the stone. That was like a makeshift chimney. So they let all of the heat come up here into the bedroom, what would have been the bedroom. And yeah, then the smoke would leave via the roof there. But yeah, a stunning, stunning, gorgeous little stone property. I think we should have a little look around the rest of the land, should we?
Yeah.
Righto. So there is not too much to see on the rest of the land here because most of it is forestry. And of course, once you've seen a bit of forestry, it all looks roughly the same. But as you come up of these beautiful couple of floating steps this side here, you come into the couple of terraces that the farm has here, where the fruit trees are all planted. So yeah, you've got a couple of lovely, lovely fruit trees here, and a gorgeous view looking out from the stone cottage there. Mariana's double checking that I locked the door right, I think. Is it good? Good. Here is where they had the water mine, and that would flow into this makeshift tank here. Of course, it's empty nowadays because no one lives here. So there's no need for them to have water, but that can quickly be cleaned out, or by putting a borehole or something, you could definitely get some water flowing there again. And then a lovely, lovely young peach tree there. And the fact that the young trees here, the young fruit trees, especially soft fruit trees like peaches and cherries and apricots and things, the fact that they're growing without any irrigation tells you that there actually is quite a bit of water here. And you will see that now because we are going to go down to the Prior Fluvial for a drink. So I think we need a refreshment.
Yeah,
it is warm today. It is probably about, what, 42 degrees, I think, today, isn't it?
Yeah, it's supposed to be much hot today. Yeah.
Much hot today. I think today's going to be the hottest one of the week, isn't it? In the whole of Portugal, yeah. Is that right? Yeah.
It's the record. I'll read about it.
It's the record, is it? Yeah. So yeah, we are in a bit of a heat wave at the moment. You do expect it to be warm this time of year in the beginning of July, but maybe not this warm, maybe not 42 degrees, you know, but yeah, but we are going to be expecting quite a few weeks of nice hot summer sun now. But if you are interested in this farm, please feel free, drop me an email. I'm going to put that on the screen here. And yeah, I can either put you in contact with the owner, or I can come and take you around this farm, or whatever you want. But yeah, I think now, Mariana, we're going to go and have a cold drink down at the Prior Fluvial, show you the river somewhat, and yeah, get refreshed. Yeah. Okay, we're now back in the farmhouse. I'm in the kitchen, and yeah, I'm feeling a little bit peckish, so I'm going to rustle me and Mariana up a little something for lunch. Today I've got here, it's a hot day, so we want something nice and light, and I'm a big fan of seafood. So I've got here some gilthead sea bream. These are Mediterranean farmed sea bream, and they're named gilthead because of the gold bar that they have across the bridge of the nose there. We've got three different colours of cherry tomatoes here, some extra virgin olive oil from our own farm here, some five pepper, some salt, some flat leaf parsley, some nice and hot dried out Malagueta chili peppers, some garlic, and of course some white wine as well. So yeah, let's get cracking. Yesterday.
vessels out of sight, reaching for the ground. As we're long alone, we lose track of time. Let up high, now we climb. Oh, oh, oh. Dreamy, breezy, we go.
Okay, we just had lunch and it was absolutely fantastic. We're now walking up past some of our grapevines here that we have on the run next to the main cherry orchard, up to the sheep barn. We've got the vineyard that's just up there on the next terrace, and quite a lot of vines on this farm, about 3,000 vines. So that produces many hundreds of litres of wine. And yeah, it makes quite a nice wine as well. And it looks like we're going to be in for quite a nice wine this year. There's lots of grapes. And they really, really seem to be doing well, which we're very pleased about because we had quite a poor cherry season. So that means that hopefully we're going to have a nice wine season this year. We've just, however, got up here to the sheep barn. I've got Mariana and Chloe with me, and we're about to have a little check on the sheep, see how they're all getting on, and look at the pigeons, which I'm sure you guys are all used to now. We look at them nearly every video. Hey, Chloe, how's it going? How's it going? You've got broccoli all over your mouth. Have you just eaten your lunch?
She have a soup.
Oh, bless her heart.
She's like it.
She's just started crawling as well, hasn't she? She's crawling now, and she's crawling all over the shop. She's been crawling for about, I don't know, about a week, week and a half, something like that.
Something, yeah.
Something like that. So she's crawling everywhere now. And yeah, I think she's going to be a little handful, isn't she? Bless her heart. Bless her heart. Not in the sheep pen. I don't know what you're going to find there on the floor. And she's just started saying mama.
Yeah.
A couple of weeks back, didn't she? About 2 weeks ago. And she just started saying papa about two days ago. So she's just starting to find her vocal cords as well, aren't you, Chloe?
Yeah.
Aren't you, Chloe? Hey. Hey. Bless her heart. Okay, let's have a little peek at the sheep, shall we?
Yeah.
Got my trusty crook here, which I'm going to need because I can hear Godfrey. He's got a hey guys. He's got a rather deep bar to him, a rather deep bleat, so you can hear when he's in the field. And he does like to headbutt, so I'm going to be in front and make sure that Mariana and Chloe are behind me, and I've got the crook on me, so he shouldn't be a problem. And I think by the look of it, all you girls are sitting in the barn, keeping out of the sun, in the shade. Don't blame you. Seems like the right thing to do to me. Hey girls. Hey boys. How's it going? How are we all? You're all looking nice and shorn, nice and neat. And as we go into the pigeon pen here, all of the sheep have done a runner. I think we're going to shear them again. And yeah, we have got our new little baby here.
Dodo's brother. Hey, how's it going? Nearly ready to leave now. This is the dad on the right-hand side, and the mother just flew out of the door there. And I think this little baby is just about, you can see there's another couple of eggs there. They are breeding machines. They absolutely pump eggs out like mad. And I think this baby is just about finding its wings. It's been outside in the loft and inside as well. So I think it's flying around now, although not very well. It's sort of half flying. And yeah, we've got a little Carrie in here with us. Don't know if Chloe wants to say hi to Carrie.
Hey Carrie.
Do you want to say hi, Chloe?
Hey Carrie.
Carrie was one of the bottle babies that got given to us last summer. So she's just about a year old now, isn't she? I think she's about 11 months old. I think it was August we got given her.
Yeah, I think it's before my birth. So yeah, August.
Yeah, I think she's about 11 months old, bless her heart. Yeah. So she was the bottle baby. So she's really fitted into the flock quite well. Yeah. And was it 3 days ago she had her tag put in, didn't she, into her ear?
Yes.
So she's now a fully fledged member of the flock, and she's ours forever, and she's got her number now. So she's got her earring in, and she's got her number.
Yeah.
Hey, Chloe. Yeah. Mariana, do you have something to say about the pigeons? I think.
Yeah, I say Dodo.
Dodo. Dodo.
Dodo. He's flower.
Yep. So the door was open this week when we were. Hey Chloe, the door was open this week when we were giving them food and water.
Yes.
At one point.
And he fly away.
Yep.
So we think, oh.
What a shame. Yes. Yeah, what a shame. Yeah, he's gone.
Next morning, when I give the food and water, I see him in a tree. So I try to give the food.
Yeah.
I try to give the food on the floor everywhere and he's not coming. But I see he tried coming in the door.
Yep.
So I go far away, open the door, and he go inside again.
Yeah, so that was somewhat of an experiment, really, wasn't it? He accidentally flew out of the cage.
Yes.
Yeah, Chloe, yeah. You really are getting vocal. So he accidentally flew out of the cage when the door was open, like you said. And so I thought to myself, well, maybe really that's a good opportunity for us to see if they will actually come back. And it seems they will, because you come here in the afternoon. He was sitting. Was he sitting on the tree or was he sitting on top of the barn?
The next morning.
Say,
oh, he'll not come back.
Yeah.
But
yeah.
In the morning when I come in, wish the water and food to give, he's in there. So I just opened the door.
So you opened the door and he flew back in.
Yes.
So fantastic. Yeah.
Yes, I saved the dodo.
Bless her heart. So that tells me that the pigeons really are ready to be let out now and be free range animals. So this week we're going to open the door to them and let them free range on the farm. I think that'll be fantastic for them, won't it? That'll be very nice indeed. And now that we know that they'll come back, we feel much more confident with the proof. Yeah.
Yeah. Before we're upset because Dad won't he come back, so he go come back for us again. Yes. Yeah. You will come back? Yay!
Yeah.
Yeah.
So yeah, that pretty much brings an end to this week here on the farm. We had a look around that absolutely amazing property for sale in Sarzedes, and if anybody is interested in that, then please do send me an email. My email's on the screen here so you can see it. And that is a wonderful farm. Any questions or any viewings or whatever, let me know and I can put you in contact with the owner, or I can do any translations if you'd prefer. No problem whatsoever. We cooked that wonderful dourada, the gilt-head bream, and that was very, very nice indeed. And we've been up, seen the pigeons, seen the sheep, and it's been a very nice week indeed, hasn't
it?
It's been very nice indeed. But yeah, we hope you all have an absolutely fantastic week. And we look forward to seeing you all again next week. Thanks a lot. Bye-bye.